So then it was eyes to optics. I think now we should change the heading to eyes to robotics. Yeah. So I'm Dr. Deepak. I work at the Kovai Medical Center. So as of history of bronchoscopy, the importance is that when we started out, we didn't have anything, you know, to, you know, look into the airways. This is in the 1800s. So I kind of divided this talk into parts where we discuss each part of development of how the bronchoscope came into use and how it has reached the current scenario. So I call this as pre-rigid era, where we didn't have a rigid bronchoscope. Then era of the rigid bronchoscope, then era of the fiber optic, flexible and video bronchoscopy, era of the endobronchial ultrasound, and resurgence of the rigid and therapeutic bronchoscopy. And now, of course, we will call it next session where robotics have come in. Three prerequisites that are necessary for anyone to look into the airways are instruments for inspection, suitable light sources, and sufficient anesthesia. It's a very interesting thing that, you know, this is not available back in the 1800s when they began. So when we look at it, we are already given all these tools, and how these tools came in and how they were, you know, built, and how many people have actually worked to develop these tools is very important to understand, because if you want to go forward, you need to know your back. In the pre-rigid era, the times of development of field of endoscopy itself. So tools for visualization of the interior of the body cavities were developed in this period. You have to remember that the illumination was the biggest challenge, because the light bulb itself came only in 1879. So I'll start with Dr. Philip Pozzini, who invented something called lit lighter. It was called a light conductor. He reported that he was able to see the upper end of the esophagus in 1806. This is the actual picture of the apparatus. But it was kind of not taken up very well by the medical fraternity, and they called it a magic lantern into the human body. They kind of ridiculed him. And of course, in the end of 3 years, he dies because of typhoid. At that time, he mentioned that every invention owes its origin to a happy combination of various circumstances. It is always born as a child, and like a child, it keeps becoming more nearly perfect by stepwise progression. So our bronchoscope has actually gone through this process. So in the pre-rigid era, we will have to mention a little bit about esophageal mirrors. Of course, everyone knows about the glottoscope, and we also know about Garcia, who was a singer who looked at the, and we've got the laryngoscope because of him, 1855. So going back on the history of endoscopy itself, so Antonin Jean Deseremax was the father of endoscopy. He's a French urologist, November 29, 1853, urethroscope. The Academy of he invented the urethroscope, and he illuminated with gasogene, a combination of alcohol and turpentine, and called this technique as endoscopy. The Greek word endo, within, and scopin, to view or observe. So you can actually see those live pictures of how this thing was done. So he actually used it for his urological practice. Next comes Dr. Kusumal. All of us know about Dr. Kusumal. Studied the technique of a sword swallower. So then they had this, you know, sword swallowers who would swallow. So he got an idea that if you are able to swallow a sword, some, you know, for entertainment, he could definitely pass a tube into the esophagus. So in 1868, he passed a modified Deseremax urethroscope into the esophagus and diagnosed carcinoma. And he modified the esophagoscope. He was teacher to Gustav Killian at the University of Strasbourg. But then this becomes a little more interesting, because he asked the sword swallower to swallow it, and he was not willing to do that for a medical. University of Berlin, who was trying to do something on something called otoscopy, and Killian was inspired by it, and he took interest in it and started developing it. Initially, he worked on cadavers, tracheostomized patients. He also worked on voluntary subjects. Now, coming to the point about was referred to Dr. Killian. He was the only guy who was actually doing it. And previously, you should know that, you know, whenever there is a foreign body ingestion, right away the patient dies, or, you know, he has a long drawn illness and he's eventually not going to survive. He found a foreign body in the right main stem bronchus by probing with Kirsten's laryngoscope. So, and he wouldn't do anything on the same day. He even sent out for a surgeon's word, because at that time they would, you know, do a tracheotomy and try to get in and take out the forceps. But then the surgeon refused. Following day, he used a 25 centimeters Michaelis Rosenheim esophagoscope, illuminated with an external light source and a head mirror, and the patient was given topical anesthesia with cocaine. He had to remove the whole equipment as the whole thing was not coming out, like all of us face. So this is the technique, and this is the first time somebody actually looked into the airway and took out a foreign body. This is actual picture of Dr. Killian. After performing two more of the foreign body removal procedure, Dr. Killian felt confident on the technique and he called it direct bronchoscopy. So that's where bronchoscopy comes from. Presented the technique at the Congress of German Laryngologists in Heidelberg on 29th of May 1898. So this is the first representation of bronchoscopy all over the world. After this, Freiburg became a mecca of bronchoscopy. Everybody was going to bronchoscopy to learn bronchoscopy, to, you know, send patients there. And then this went on, and it became one of the sought-after centers to learn bronchoscopy. So Killian was an interesting man. I would like to elaborate a little bit on him. He developed the technique of suspension laryngoscopy, the variant of which is still in use, developed surgical resection, SMR. He also invented the technique of sinus drainage, Killian's operation, contributed to various other inventions. You know, a brilliant mind and innovator. And he applied fluoroscopy for probing, you know, foreign bodies in 1895. That is way, way back. Metallic dilators were used and stents placed for stenosed airways. Described endoluminal radiotherapy in cancer of the larynx by mesothelium. So this is so much to do in a lifespan. And Killian was an excellent academician, and he was a very pleasant man. Created a school of laryngologists, students who dominated, his students dominated the field for many, many years. In 1921, he died of gastric cancer. So you can see those mannequins you used to train students for. And next comes Dr. Chevalier Jackson, who needs real mention. Chevalier Jackson was a man of dedication who already knew what he wanted to do as he studied medicine. He got into ENT as he finished his medicine, and he was keen on learning bronchoscopy. He's called the father of American bronchoesophageology. He developed the bronchoscope with distal illumination. He's the one who really innovated on the bronchoscope. Rigid bronchoscope was a very cumbersome instrument back then, and he started developing it. He would have a room just to, you know, work on his instruments. And as pulmonologists, we always need to have that innovative mind in front. Not just the instruments given by the companies, we also need to think about how to do it. That is what actually Dr. Killian Chevalier Jackson told. Endoscopic instrumentation was brought to a high degree of excellence, and mortality rate of foreign body cases dropped from 50% to 2% due to his efforts. And this man was so great, he's a philanthropist, he said, I will not patent any of my innovations. And so that the knowledge is spread, and he goes up and everybody is able to use the knowledge that I'm developing. He wrote the book dedicated to Dr. Christian Killian. He went around and learned the initial technique from Dr. Killian. So he has dedicated this to Dr. Killian. And this book is available online, dedicated to the book on tracheobronchoscopy, esophagoscopy, and gastroscopy. So what you have to remember is, at that time, they were all together. And he was a perfectionist and wanted teaching to be perfected on animals. He did not want experimentation on human beings. There is more to talk about him. He also simultaneously held 5 chairs of laryngology in his hometown, Pittsburgh and Philadelphia. His son also was a laryngologist and successor at Temple University, Philadelphia. He's a founder of Pan American Association of Otorhinolaryngology and Bronchology and International Bronchoesophageal Society. This is again another book written by him. It's a very interesting book where he writes about unsuccessful cases of bronchoscopy for foreign bodies. They were ready to document their unsuccessful cases also. You know, they also document about fluoroscopy. Some of the quotes from Dr. Jackson is very important to understand the kind of mindset they had at that time. So you look at it, he says that, you know, educate your eyes and fingers. Be sure you're right, but not too sure. cry over spilled milk enough to memorize how you spilled it. Let your left hand know what your right hand does and how to do it. And the last but not the least, makeshifts make mortality. So he was somebody who wanted things to be perfect before it was put up on the patient. He also had this famous talk that, you know, nature helps, but she is no more interested in the survival of your patient than survival of attacking pathogenic bacteria. These are all quotes that, you know, highlight the kind of individual he was and the kind of excellence he was looking forward to. Then it comes to spread of bronchology, so it goes on disseminating. In 1907, after training under Killian, Iniko Kichi Kubo of Kyushu University in Fukuoka introduced bronchoscopy in Japan. In Estiba followed him after training with Brunnings. Joe Ono trained under Jackson, founded the Japanese Bronchoesophageal Society in 1949. So this is the other man that we need to talk about, Dr. Killian's chair and Dr. Shigeto Ikeda. So coming to era of flexible bronchoscopy, Shigeto Ikeda was a thoracic surgeon at National Cancer Center, Tokyo. He felt Killian's chair was too cumbersome and started to develop the flexible bronchoscope in 1964. By then, the fiber optics had slowly started to take its place in the scene of endoscopy. This is the actual picture of National Cancer Center, Tokyo. So he was also a very meticulous and perfectionist. In the spring of 1964, Machida Corporation was requested to make a prototype of the first flexible fiber bronchoscope. In 1965, Olympus was also requested to do the same. The first one was completed in 23rd July 1966. Dr. Ikeda presented the device to the world in Copenhagen on August 17 to 19, 1966. So I just want to describe a little more on the development. So original literature published by Ikeda on the flexible bronchoscope and its development. The description goes on to speak on the development of various prototypes and evolution. He goes on to describe the advantages of flexible bronchoscope over rigid. So this is the original picture of the top paper. And he was chief of service bronchoesophageal division. NCC is a really interesting place, very dedicated. He continued to actually work on the flexible bronchoscope even after having a stroke. In 1990s also, he was there. And this prototypes of Machida Corporation and prototypes of Olympus Corporation. For those of you who are wondering, what is this Machida Corporation? This is the parent company of Pentax originally. And so many prototypes, so many times he keeps rejecting multiple prototypes and then comes up the original structure. So this is the structure of the original flexible bronchoscope. IP is light source. Of course, this you have to remember that you're still on the era where you are actually looking at it through the eyes and you don't have a video. This is Ikeda Dr. Ikeda with the bronchoscope. He introduced and popularized flexible bronchoscopy throughout the world, founded the World Association for Bronchology. Ikeda was also a forerunner in the development of video bronchoscope. So Asahi Pentax Corporation developed a prototype video bronchoscope in 1987. The fiber optic was replaced with CCD chip. That is when we start seeing it on the monitors, unlike seeing it through the eyes. Image resolution was better with this technology. This is a schematic representation of a modern-day video bronchoscope. Now comes the hybrid scope. So we've developed and we've come up introducing the CCD chip above so we can make it even smaller with a 4 millimeter and outer diameter of in a working channel of 2 millimeter working channel. To summarize this, bronchoesophageology was developed by laryngologists and it turned out and shifted to pulmonology and gastroenterology and we became bronchoscopists and gastroenterology became the endoscopists. So this was not enough for us. We wanted to go beyond the era of the endobronchial ultrasound. Everything we see hides another thing. We always want to see what is hidden by what we see. There is an interest in which is hidden and which the visible doesn't show us. This is exactly why the EBUS came in. So first reported literature on EBUS, Thomas Herter from Germany worked with Professor Hanrath, who was a cardiologist, published the first report of endovascular application of ultrasound, used Boston SC Sonicath 2.6 and 6.2 and 6.9 French, which rotated 10 to 15 RPM and advocated its use in central tumors and analysis of wall and lymph node and peripheral lesions. This data was published with 100 patients, and he used it with the Olympus BFT 20D. After this, nothing more was published from his end as he left the institute. And no more work was done from his end. Then Dr. Heinrich D. Baker, Thorax Clinic, Heidelberg, he introduced the idea of using the ultrasonic probe in airways in 1989. So this is 1989. Remember this day. because it takes another 10 years. By then, Olympus had developed the radial ultrasonic probe for use in gastroenterology. So this is the picture. Then there is also mention of Dr. Roysuke Ono, who from National NCC again, developed the ultrasonic bronchoscope for diagnosis of lymph node staging in the hilum and mediastinum with Aloco Company 1993. This is the paper published by Dr. Norike Kurimoto. A 2 mm ultrasonic catheter was used for diagnosis of PPM. This describes the content and lesions, how they are. Literature was published classifying the lesion based on the appearance of the lesions. EBUS probe was finally launched worldwide in 1999. It took 10 years for the development of radial EBUS. So I'm talking about the radial probe. In 1999, the probe was launched. Specifics was this way. And now comes the next part, that is they were not happy with the radial probe, so they wanted something beyond that, so the convex probe development. So this is the puncture scope development of the convex EBUS. Throughout having a real ultrasound guided aspiration of mediastinal, so when you have the flexible channel and you have an ultrasound probe, but you don't know how to combine both, these are the parts where they try to combine it both. Parallel insertion of the needle via the ultrasound and the ultrasound via the rigid was tried. Later, double Newman scope was developed. That's called the puncture scope. Then the next thing that comes up is the bump scope. So here they put in an ultrasonic probe, ultrasonic processor in front, and this was called bump scope, but it was not that good at resolution, and it was later skipped. The ultrasonic image of the scope was poor, and the whole idea was abandoned. Last prototype came out in 2009, was later abandoned by BF convex system, came into light. So BF convex systems are what we have now, curvilinear electronic array at the tip in front of the fiber optic and opening of the biopsy channel and insertion section of less than 7 mm. The further models of hybrid technology was applied, image quality improved. By 2004, the equipment was launched with dedicated needle system for real-time TBNF mediastinal nodes. So we've almost come to the end of EBUS. So this is how our evolution took place. The development stills continue, add refinements to the equipment. 4 mm EBUS scope yet to hit, I think. So the last part is resurgence of rigid bronchoscopy and therapeutic bronchoscopy. Future of bronchoscopy is bright and clear with newer developments and added every day. The modern bronchoscopy is an ever-changing field. Contributions will be discussed as the day goes on. Many of our pioneers are with us today. Dr. Duman, Dr. Hermanton, Felix, and so on and so forth. So I'll just summarize this whole story. So 1800s, we have the Philip Bozzini, 1800 and 6 liter. Then we have Antonin Jean Desiromax. Then we have Dr. Kusumol, esophagoscopy. Then we have Dr. Killian, 1897, bronchoscopy. Then we have Chevalier Jackson, American bronchoesophagology. Then we have Dr. Ikeda, 1966, flexible bronchoscopy. And then we have Shigeta Ikeda again in 1987, video bronchoscopy. And then we have Kurimoto and others doing the ultrasound. And then we have the resurgence of rigid and therapeutic bronchoscopy. Hari wanted me to include robotics. I said, this is news, not history. So I want to summarize what I talked. In our enthusiasm for the present activities and our anticipation to things to come, it is indeed timely to pause and occasionally look backward at some of the achievements of our predecessors. These are apt to be viewed with tolerance, if not amusement, as we forget that at the time of their inception, they were quite as novel and advanced as of the innovations which we are brought forward today. Yet the history of all scientific invention is a progression from first glimpse of a basic principle through crude and clumsy applications to more and more refined and perfection. Alas, it is so easy to forget those whose efforts, persistence, and enthusiasm we are unable to do constantly better work. How often it is that the pioneers must be forced not only to contend with native obstacles inherent in the problem, but with the scorn and discouragement of the less imaginative confreres who sometimes through ignorance, sometimes through envy, belittle his efforts and seek to discredit his discoveries. This added hindrance to medical progress is by no means extinct today. Museum cabinets are filled out with outmoded and antiquated devices over which some enthusiast has spent hours of labor and thought, not only to see them as supplanted by others and better ones, but without this mechanical evolution, we would find ourselves vastly handicapped in our efforts to progress. Thank you.